Thank you so much for watching the AI Weekly Update series from Henry AI Labs up to June 2nd, 2021. In last week's AI Weekly Update video, we looked at the Measuring Coding Challenge Competence with Apps, a really exciting use of deep learning with Python code data, where the model takes in as prompt a natural language description of something like, say, a hacker rank or like elite code, algorithms and data structures, coding challenge problem, and it generates Python code that has to pass these test cases. So also interestingly is that it passes these test cases, and it's not just matching this with some annotated ground truth or a gold summary, as is the terminology in these text generation systems. So this was a really exciting system, and seeing on it a little more, they've updated the revision to May 27th, increasing GPT-Neo's success from 15% to 20% of passing these introductory problems in the test cases. So I thought it'd be interesting to start the next AI Weekly Update with a little bit more on the papers that are developing deep learning with coding data. We have Project CodeNet, a really enormous corpus of this code data, something like 50 million lines of code or something like that. CoSQA annotated query code pairings for doing code search and question answering, and then self-supervised bug detection and repair. And I really wanted to stay on this idea of deep learning with code data, which I think is a really exciting research area for deep learning. Next up in the world of reinforcement learning, it looks like we have something really exciting on the horizon from DeepMind already with the release of the Android environment. So they've published a position paper titled Reward is Enough, and we'll take apart the paper and Yannick Kilcher's analysis of the paper as well, where they outline this concept that if you have a sufficiently complex environment like this Android environment, that just maximizing a reward signal is enough to learn all these sub-skills like memory, language, or social intelligence. All these things are just a subset of trying to optimize for maximizing rewards. So overall, the paper itself doesn't have too much technical details or outlines of how to really build these systems, but it's this position argument of saying that all we need is a sufficiently complex environment, and then reward is enough to learn all these skills and create artificial general intelligence. So then on the realm of this sufficiently complex environment, they've released Android environment. And this is a really interesting environment. It's very different from things like OpenAI Jim or the Mujoco or the DeepMind Control Suite or Atari, in that it's just an interface with the Android operating system. It could do things like find directions between, say, the ice cream store and the supermarket, or any kind of task that could run on the Android operating system is now easy to interface these reinforcement learning agents with. So hopefully that will lead to some really interesting advances from DeepMind, the makers of, you know, the AlphaGo and all these different things. So it should be really interesting to see what they're trying to build with this Android environment. Next up, we have a new development in text to image generation, a 4 billion parameter text to image transformer model titled CogView, mastering text to image generation via transformers. So with the birth of the, well, this has started with things like StackGAN, and DALL-E isn't the first model to do this, but DALL-E really, you know, blew this open with things like an avocado in the shape of an armchair, those kinds of generations. You can go to the OpenAI DALL-E blog post to see some examples of this, but this text to image generation thing is really exciting. And when I was studying this CogView model and reading their paper, I found a really great blog post on the vector quantized variational autoencoder. So later in the video, the weekly update video, we're going to take apart this vector quantized variational autoencoder thing that is really powering some of these latest advances in the text to image generation, and how you can combine it with, say, the autoregressive model on the prior, and more details that we'll get into later on. So then data augmentation and prior knowledge, the inductive biases that we use in deep learning, we have some interesting papers, the first of which is this idea of augmentation multiplicity. So in your current data augmentation pipeline, you probably take the image, text, or whatever it is, and form one augmented example from it, compared to, say, four augmented examples, 8, 16, and so on. So this paper is increasing this multiplicity and showing benefits by, say, going up to 8 and 16 and so on, and showing how this reduces this variance in the gradient and how it overall helps this augmentation pipeline. Then this other paper on the bias against inductive biases is, we've seen this, you know, confusion in the space of neural architectures, where it, now it looks like the multi-layer perceptron with the modifications, the MLP mixer, the gated MLP, and these like Fourier transformation networks, all these things are like blowing open the lid on these neural architectures, and it's confusing to say the MLP convolution transformer attention layers. So this is bringing them all down on a similar parameter scale to study them and see what kind of biases they're capturing and overall analyzing the real how well this prior knowledge is being cooked into these different architectures. Although the primary use of these large language models has been for transfer learning, where we first learn the language modeling task and then we pre-train these representations for some downstream supervised learning task where we don't have as much labeled data to learn it from scratch, we're also looking more into using this language modeling task in order to do text generation and generate data. And this generated data could be the point of the task, say like summarization or open-ended abstractive question answering, where generating the text is the point of the task, or it could be for generating labeled data, such as say natural language inference data and so on, for the sake of training a classifier and distilling it that way, where you generate the data and then you distill it by training a model on that generated data from the language model. So this paper, Medically Aware GPT-3, a part of this really interesting catalog from the ACL 2021 conference on natural language processing for medical dialogue summarization, is about using the GPT-3 model to generate this snippet summaries of doctor-patient interactions, and using this filtering on making sure that the generated model is retaining salient information and not hallucinating. I don't know if it explicitly tests hallucination, but overall looking at how we can filter the outputs of the GPT-3 generation to produce synthetic data augmentation to train these models that can summarize a medical dialogue between a doctor and a patient. Next up, we have BYT5, short for Byte T5. So getting away from tokenizers and processing text sequences or any data sequence directly with the UTF-8 byte encodings. And they describe how this allows you to reallocate the parameter distribution. So putting more weight on the encoder and these encoder, decoder, transformer designs, and some other modifications that they make to get away from tokenizers, and thinking that tokenizers is kind of a hacky tech debt bottleneck in these language processing designs. So then we'll look at knowledge inheritance for pre-trained language models. A couple of ideas around this idea of distilling the knowledge from language models to each other, where say you first train a larger, smaller model and then distill it into another one. A really interesting success of these knowledge distillation training strategies that have helped with either compressing models or even say self-training with Noisy Student, where it forms a useful bias in the training procedure to scale it up and have this kind of soft target distribution over the labels. So rounding out the AI Weekly Update, we have a new Keras code example on sequence-to-sequence neural machine translation that's really useful. We have some interesting details around the space of deep learning, the Anthropic company spinoff from OpenAI that's raised $124 million. OpenAI's $100 million startup fund to use their GPT-3 API, which I think is really interesting to think that the GPT-3 API is so powerful that you can really build these businesses on top of it. I'm a little skeptical about that personally, but an interesting thing that we'll look at later in the video. Then Hugging Face has a newsletter with some updates about what they're doing, all really exciting stuff. And then Papers with Code is now documenting where there's a dataset loader. So one of the really cool things about Hugging Face is their datasets library. So if you're using natural language processing datasets for your work, you can just easily get it into, say, your Keras PyTorch workflow through the use of this Hugging Face dataset loader. So Papers with Code is annotating which of these papers, I think they index it by the papers that reference the dataset. And then they'll tell you, say, like Torch Vision, Torch Text, or something like that has a dataset loader built in. So overall, this should be an interesting episode of AI Weekly Update, going through these different advances in deep learning and artificial intelligence. In the last AI Weekly Update video, I was really excited to present Measuring Coding Competence with the APPS dataset. This is a really exciting dataset that has 10,000 different programming algorithmic data structures problems that people use to practice for coding interviews, overall develop your coding skills. And they have the, I think it was something like 130,000 human annotated, say like the ground truth submissions to these problems. Say if you wanna do supervised learning where you take in the prompt and then try to exactly text generate the human annotated ground truth for the sake of training a model like this, or whatever training strategy you wanna use, self-supervised learning or however you are gonna structure this supervised learning task and so on. But here's another source of data for developing deep learning with coding data. So Project CodeNet, a large-scale AI for code dataset for learning a diversity of coding tasks, a little bit less of the different prompts as they describe. They have 4,000 problems, compared to 10,000 from the apps paper from last week. But here's the really interesting thing. Project CodeNet has approximately 14 million submissions with 500 million lines of code, as mentioned in the abstract. So that's a lot of data for doing this. Diversity of languages, C++, Python, and so on is shown in this chart here. Comparison with previous data sets. So, you know, I don't have too much to say about this, but it is really interesting to see more data sets available. They describe how they're using these online judge websites, AIZU and AtCoder. This is how they're collecting the data as people submit to these challenges, and there probably is some noise with some poor submissions. It says a large fraction of the code samples are known to compile and run correctly on the test cases. Well, you know, 50%, not that large of a fraction. But anyway, so this is a new data set for developing these kinds of models for deep learning with, say, Python and algorithmic challenges. One of, in my opinion, the most interesting developments in deep learning recently. So next up, let's think about the kinds of tasks that we can do with deep learning with code data. So there, the GLU benchmark for natural language processing summarized these different tasks like text classification, natural language inference, say duplicate question detection in the core question pairs data set. The idea of GLU and natural language processing was to bring together all these different tasks and then have one benchmark where you say, how well does this model perform on all these different supervised learning tasks? Well, we also have CodeX GLU, and this is a really interesting paper that goes through the different things that we're doing with supervised learning task construction with code data. So say, you know, same idea, duplicate detection, in this case, query code matching, or bug detection, so on. I don't have too much of this memorized at the top of my head, but CodeX GLU, it's a different paper to check out if you're interested in this idea. So, but this paper particularly, CoSQA, is 20,000 web queries for code search and question answering. So what they're doing is they're using the Bing search engine in order to filter these queries and match them. So you have a real world distribution of queries that people ask about Python code. Python check if path is absolute path or relative path, and then you have the code answer to this query. So this is the idea behind the data set. I can do things like search, or you could do question answering. Does this code snippet contain the answer to this natural language question? So here's another data set, 20,000 of these pairs. They describe how they clean and filter this data set and so on. And then they give some examples of different queries in the code, some explanations for the sake of interpreting the, you know, what this data set is about. And then I think they train the CodeBERT model. And also really interestingly is their use of this code contrastive learning that they dubbed the CodeClear algorithm. So the idea of contrastive learning, super popular self-supervised learning algorithm, you make positive pairs similar, negative positive pairs dissimilar. So the idea that they use here is they have in-batch augmentation. That's where you say, take the query, make it dissimilar from all the other code samples. So to return to this, so say the query, say this is a sampled mini batch of the data, as in mini batch SGD for deep learning, and you sample this one, Python check if argument is list, and you use this code snippet, this one, as negative pairs, and you push those representations apart to hopefully have this semantic alignment between this query code pair. And then what they do is they apply data augmentation in the form of these easy data augmentations with random deletion, insertion, synonym swap, this kind of set of augmentations to perturb the query a little bit, and then also have this positive alignment to try to, you know, blur out the form a little bit and make it a little more robust to this representation learning framework. And overall, this contrastive learning between the query code pairs does improve the performance significantly, as they report, I think up to even 10%, which is quite an improvement for this kind of algorithm. So overall, another really interesting data set, thinking more about what are the kinds of tasks that we can construct when doing deep learning with code data. Next up is self-supervised bug detection and repair. So what this paper is presenting, their bug lab framework, is similar to, say, the Electra model in natural language processing, or generative adversarial networks, or overall adversarial training. In this case, the way that you set up this self-supervised bug detection task is you have an adversarial model that's going to select how to introduce this bug. So the adversarial controller is seeing how to perturb the code such that the, you know, the hero, the solver of the debugging, is unable to detect the bug, and then you, you know, search through the negatives to try to make the training stronger. So that's the high level framework of how they're implementing this model and how they're building this debugger system by having an adversary search for how to perturb it, and then you learn that way. So it's an interesting search strategy, thinking about the self-supervised learning task. Bug detection is definitely an interesting one because we can really automate it by passing it through the compiler, which we have access to in these Python training loops. And it's overall a really interesting self-supervised learning strategy. Improves 30% by using this adversarial design on their test data set, maybe a small data set of only 2,300 bugs compared to, say, the last one that had all these different test cases and so on. But the high-level takeaway, I think, from this paper is just thinking about how do we set up these self-supervised learning tasks with code data, and even so you have more signal because you can pass it through the compiler to get this kind of bug detection and so on, and you can run the code, which I think is a really interesting part of this. Authors from DeepMind have published a pretty interesting position paper titled Reward is Enough. And one part about this that I think is so interesting is that it's not written for just the deep learning audience. Say, like, this video that I'm making is, for a group of people who I assume know what reinforcement learning is and all these different things. But this is, I think, directed at the science community at large. And coming back to the deep learning ideas, it's similar to Richard Sutton's The Bitter Lesson, this idea that these algorithmic advances aren't really pushing deep learning forward. It's really just the scaling up of the model sizes, scaling up the data set sizes. And this Reward is Enough paper is saying that if you have a sufficiently complex environment and then you have, a large model, and say, I think just, gradient descent is all you need, and then just, or however you structure with, say, proximal policy optimization or soft factor critic, however you're doing this maximized reward in the reinforcement learning framework, this idea that maximizing reward is enough to achieve all these sub-abilities of intelligence that, we break apart and explore further in deep learning, like, say, exploration or social intelligence and multi-agent learning or, language acquisition and all these different kinds, or memory and all these different kinds of ideas, are really just subsets of maximizing reward. And an agent that is learning to maximize reward will discover these sub-skills on its own without you needing to inject this prior knowledge into the artificial intelligence system. So the paper, it goes through, it's written to, I think, a broader audience to try to get more people interested in this idea from other disciplines of science with, background the reinforcement learning problem, and then making these, not super technical arguments, but saying that reward is enough for knowledge and learning, knowledge is enough for perception, say solving perception with, these object detection, semantic segmentation, these kind of breaking apart of the problem compared to just saying maximizing reward is enough to discover this skill, and that's all you need. You don't need to really be putting bounding boxes around cats and stuff, and you just need to maximize reward to achieve perception. So overall, it's making the different arguments for how these different subtasks of intelligence can be done by just maximizing reward. If you're interested in these ideas further, I highly recommend watching Yannick Kilcher's analysis of this paper, Reward is Enough. Particularly, I really thought it was interesting, the argument around evolution and fitness as the reward, and I'm not sure exactly in the video where that is, but this idea that intelligence is a particular niche of the fitness reward function compared to, say, bacteria or these other things that don't use intelligence in the same way, which I think is an interesting view on this perspective of reward is enough with the evolutionary creation of all intelligence in the world and the fitness function as the reward and so on. So I highly recommend watching this video, taking apart this paper even further. Powering this thesis that reward is enough is the latest environment for using reinforced learning. We've seen development environments like OpenAI's Gym, where we have, say, the bipedal walking agent or the cart pole balancing and these other tasks, or the DeepMind control suite, as they're listed here, the Atari games, this Mujoco thing, and StarCraft 2, mostly things that are either game playing or robotic control, like controlling the forces on the joints and things like this. So now we have the Android environment, the Android learning environment, and what this is it's letting you just interact freely with the Android operating system to do whatever kind of task you can imagine doing on a phone, like creating a contact, or using the calculator, or using the using any of these kind of apps to run some kind of task instead of some kind of reward. So in their research paper, they break apart the details of exactly how the interface is. The agent can make decisions to touch, lift the XY coordinates of the phone operating system or the phone interface. And this is showing the different things that you can do, like browse the internet or watch a movie or play these different games. And the games thing is also interesting. At the end they show 2048 solitaire, and then they show this Battle of Polytopia game that looks like a pretty complex game, that maybe this is the best interface for using these fairly complex games that seem to have, like, some kind of maybe it's like a tower defense game or something like that. So overall, this should be a really interesting thing, seeing how, what kind of things people develop with this Android environment. Next up is the latest advances in text-to-image generation via transformer in the CogView model, a 4 billion parameter transformer with a vector-quantized variational autoencoder tokenizer to advance this problem of combining image-text representations to generate images. So they show the overall architecture of their model, where they have the input text and they have the input image, and they encode it using the vector quantized variational autoencoder and pass in the discretized codebook into tokens that you pass into a GPT-style generation architecture. But overall, breaking down the, you know, the technical details of this CogView model, I think the most interesting thing to take apart further would be the vector quantized variational autoencoder. So in preparing for this, I found this really great blog post from Charlie Snell, and I think this is the best analysis of the vector quantized variational autoencoder that I want to present in this video. So the high level overview of the variational autoencoder is to have this structuring of how the latent space is going to be distributed. So the autoencoder maps from the high resolution, high dimensional input image into a Z lower dimensional representation. It doesn't have to be a vector, the Z. It could be a, you know, it could be a tensor, it could be a grid, whatever it is. So basically the idea is that the autoencoder might put these Z latent codes into very specific points and pockets of the latent space so that it can memorize the decoding and just, you know, recognize the specific placement of it to generate the original image as it's reconstructing it. So what the variational autoencoder does is it has this structure where it says the latent space should be Gaussian distributed, and then you have this KL divergence between the distribution of these latent vectors such that the distribution looks like this compared to spread out and put in these hyper-specific points to memorize the data. So you have this structuring of the Z space of this KL divergence term, and that's kind of the high level overview. And then the other idea is that you use variational inference to then sample these Zs for generating images. So the idea of the vector quantized part of the variational autoencoder is to use discrete latent codes instead of having this continuous mapping into the latent space. So what this means is that you have this grid of the each position in this 32 by 32 latent representation indexes a discrete vector from the codebook. And the way that this works is that you use the nearest neighbor of each of the continuous mappings to the Z vectors to look up the nearest neighbor in the codebook. And then you use this idea of the straight through estimator. The straight through estimator is a way to use discrete operations with gradient descent and partial derivative optimization, where you just set the gradient to be one wherever you did this discrete operation, and then just kind of pass gradients through it, and it seems to work in some cases. And I don't know exactly what's going on with this, and I don't think too many people do, but this straight through estimator thing seems to work. You just set the gradient to be one, and then you just gradients through this discrete operation. So you look up this code book, and then you have these loss functions for learning the code book. And this is a really great illustration of the combinatorial size of the space, where you have a 512 dimensional vector for each position in the 32 by 32 codebook can lead to 2 to the 9,216 different ways of structuring this, of different ways of assembling the codebook. So with this discrete codebook, then the generator generates images. And then the next part of it is learning these Zs. And for me, this is a little fuzzy, so I'm not going to give you a great explanation of this, but they train an autoregressive model to model the distribution over these latent vectors Z for then when they want to generate a new 32 by 32 grid of latents in order to produce more images or whichever kind of data they're trying to generate. So I highly recommend going through this blog post if you're curious further about the vector quantized variational autoencoder, CogView, the latest interesting advance in this 4 billion parameter model. I also thought it was really interesting this blurred MS Coco challenge of taking in these blurry MS Coco images, where you have these text captions for the MS Coco vision language data set, or I'm not sure exactly where that is, but using that to evaluate these text image generation models, vision language models, one of the most interesting areas of deep learning as well. Next up, we have a really interesting analysis of the data augmentation pipeline used in deep learning. As stated in the first line of the abstract, in computer vision, it is standard practice to draw a single sample from the data augmentation procedure for each unique image in the mini batch. So for example, we take one cat image and then we transform it by saying rotating it, adjusting the color histogram, or doing a horizontal flip to form this augmented example for the sake of doing data augmentation. So this paper, drawing multiple augmentation samples per image during training efficiently decreases test error, is looking at increasing the number of samples that are formed from each unique image. So say forming four different augmented transformations of the A character compared to just one, and seeing how this affects the training dynamics. So the key insight is that, say you only have one augmentation, you might say that the benefit of data augmentation is from the variance in the gradient due to having these two different transformations that has some variance properties with respect to the gradient and the loss as you're doing backpropagation. So this paper is by increasing the multiplicity and stabilizing this, they show that the benefits of data augmentation are arising from bias and not variance, and they show the learning curves as you increase the number, the augmentation multiplicity, how many augmented samples you form from each original image from 1 up to 16 and so on. So a really interesting paper, an interesting idea to form more than one augmented example for each example in the original batch, and thinking about this pipeline for augmentation in deep learning. Next up, we're looking at on the bias against inductive biases. So we're looking at these different architectures, comparing the convolutional network on the top, the MLP mixer model, and then a transformer network on the bottom, on how well they can perform this task of reconstructing the original image with added noise in the form of these black dots. So overall, this discussion is around these different architectures and seeing how well they encode these different inductive biases, the local prior and the convolution. I'm not actually sure what the MLP prior is, and then transformer, the self-attention, the dynamic reparameterization idea, this idea of attend over different things, and then other things the authors describe, like the isotropic nature of these models, where you say have the same intermediate representation size in the model, so you're passing the intermediate feature vectors have the same shape. So like the UNet in a convolutional network down samples it and then up samples it with the skip connections, compared to the isotropic thing they're describing, where you say have the same resolution for all the intermediate feature maps. So overall, it's breaking down the different ways of encoding images for the sake of this image GPT style framework, and then using the different kind of blocks, convolutional blocks, mixer blocks, compared to the attention blocks, and seeing how well they each perform when using the same number of parameters. And maybe it's the case that the transformer prior really comes out at scale or something like that. These kinds of ideas of exploring these different priors between the convolution, MLP, and transformer at a smaller, more accessible scale. Next up, we have medically aware GPT-3 as a data generator for medical dialogue summarization. So to start off, we'll start off with GPT-3 as a data generator. This is this idea of generative data augmentation, where we use generative models like language models to generate training data for supervised learning. So say a question answering system, you would generate artificial question answer context tuples from, say, unlabeled data sets like Wikipedia or pre-trained language models and so on, using language models to generate data to train with, is a high-level overview of GPT-3 as a data generator. Then the application domain, medical dialogue summarization, is where you have these interactions with the doctor, where the doctor asks questions like, or they have this overall conversation, thanks for answering my questions, apart from Benadryl and hydrocortisone, have you used anything to help? No, that's everything. These kinds of like interviews where the patient reveals the problems and the medicine they're on. And then we want to summarize this for the sake of having these automated tools and clinical node analysis and all these different ideas. So this is about using GPT-3 to try to generate this synthetic data to help train these dialogue summary systems. So then the last part of it, medically aware GPT-3, is about using this filtering process of the generated summaries from GPT-3. So here's the original snippet, and then what GPT-3 says compared to GPT-3 ENS, and ENS being describing how you filter through different generations of GPT-3. So I think it's different generations of GPT-3 as in different priming context. So to go back a little further, GPT-3, the way that you help guide the generation is through this in-context learning. So you prepend it to the input, something like snippet text, snippet summary text, and then summary. So this isn't the exact example, this is the prompt, sorry about that. So the prompt is the way that you get GPT-3 to generate some text. So you put this part of it this entire part of it as the input to GPT-3, and then it starts generating. So I think you loop through different ways of priming it, and then you have this filtering based on using these additional, say like medical entity recognition models. This is the GPT ENS part, this medical entity recognizer system, to filter through the different candidate generations to pick the one that's the most, come back to the title, medically aware. And that's the samples that you use for getting more training data for training these medical dialogue summarization systems. So overall, I think this is a pretty interesting application. Definitely, I'm really interested in generative data augmentation using language models to generate data for these text generation tasks like summarization, question answering, chatbots, and so on. And overall, this is a really interesting organization, the ACL 2021. This is a workshop on natural language processing for medical conversations, and you can see all the different papers that are indexed in this catalog, in addition to our, you know, the medically aware GPT-3 as data generator for medical dialogue summarization. You can see some of the other examples in this workshop, which is a pretty interesting application. Next up is the new Byte T5 model operating on raw UTF-8 bytes of input sequences rather than using tokenizers. And this tweet thread from Colin Raffel, one of the co-authors of the paper, summarizes the motivation and the algorithms behind this paper well. So problems with tokenizers: finite fixed vocabulary, can't process new unseen languages, lack of robustness to misspelling and noise, not learned end-to-end, giant vocabulary matrices in the multilingual setting, and then technical debt in practice. So the solution is to operate on raw byte sequences, so the UTF-8 byte encodings for text data, and the main drawback is that the sequence lengths tend to increase significantly compared to using token sequences. So some of the past work, I think in a previous AI Weekly Update video, we looked at the K9 model for doing, I think what they do is they have like an architecture design, so where you compress the input heavily at the beginning of it to reduce the shape of the intermediate features in the deep neural network. So that's what he's describing here, the architectural innovations, convolutional front ends, downsampling to mitigate the increased computational cost that comes with these longer byte level sequences. And then, so, you know, what are the changes to turn this into byte level? And the idea is to reallocate how you use the parameters, make the encoder bigger and the decoder smaller, and then restructure the pre-training task with longer span mask lengths. So span BERT, and is the idea of when you don't mask out a single token, you mask out, say, 4 or 5 tokens at a time. So this is, and then they report the improvements that come with the BYT5 model. So overall, really interesting to see these transformers that are getting away, or not just transformers, but getting away from the use of tokenizers and learning this encoding end to end. The next paper is titled Knowledge Inheritance for Pre-trained Language Models. And this is addressing the idea of how to train larger and larger probabilistic language models, or pre-trained language models. This idea of using it, the knowledge distillation strategy, or as they denote, knowledge inheritance. And some interesting ideas like dynamic inheritance rate and diverse teachers and domains. So the dynamic inheritance rate is this idea of having a like an alpha weighting on how to apply the KL loss between the ground truth mass token distribution compared to the knowledge distillation soft label target distribution. And then this other idea that I think is interesting of diverse teachers and domains. So say last week in the AI Weekly Update video, we looked at the divide and contrast self-supervised learning algorithm, where you have an expert model trained on each clustered representation set of, say, heavy tailed in the wild data, and you have an expert for each of these subsets of domains. So this idea of using these experts for each subset of the data in order to train knowledge distillation, I think, is a pretty interesting approach to this as well. So a couple of interesting ideas on thinking about this framework of, as you're training language models, and how you're going to have this, how you're going to integrate this seemingly pretty effective solution of knowledge distillation and scaling up the architecture size. Keras Code Examples continues to pump out cutting-edge tutorials for deep learning, the latest of which is English to Spanish translation with a sequence-to-sequence transformer, previewing a chapter from Francois Chalet's new Deep Learning with Python second edition tutorial on implementing deep learning algorithms with Python. And this Keras Code Example series overall has been amazing and an incredible educational resource. So in this tutorial, you learn how to vectorize text using the Keras text vectorization layer, vectorization text, compared to, say, like the tokenization pipeline and how you do this in Keras, and then implementing these different ideas like the transformer and the positional embedding and so on, and really building it from scratch. So compared with, say, using like the Hugging Face transformers library, this is showing you how to really construct the architecture from scratch with the transformer encoder layer, transformer decoder layer, and the positional embedding, and showing you how to do this, showing you how to prepare this data for the model.fit, the pipeline of the sequence-to-sequence model learning, and then inference with sequence-to-sequence inference. So overall, another really awesome, really great educational tutorial on how to use Keras and how to use it for neural machine translation, showing you how to do inference with decoding the sequence and generating these translations. To quickly present a couple of interesting news things, there's a new company called Anthropic that's raised $124 million to build more reliable general AI systems. So I think this is really exciting because we've seen these incredible research efforts from OpenAI, like the multimodal neurons paper and the circuit-based interpretability. They have this thing called, I think it's called the AI microscope, where they're really looking into the connections of the neural network and seeing the different biases and, you know, what it's learned. And I think this should lead to some really incredible work and, you know, overall just an interesting thing to see this, you know, huge investment in this space. Another interesting funding announcement: OpenAI is announcing a $100 million fund for investing in startups using the OpenAI's API, which I'm assuming to mean the GPT-3 API. So I think this is a really interesting pushing of the limits of, say, these GPT-3 language model APIs. So take the text-to-text transfer transformer, the T5 model, that said that all these natural language processing tasks can be unified in this text input, text output language, which really resembles language modeling. So are these language models powerful enough that they can really do all of these common supervised learning tasks just through the language modeling interface? I think that's a really interesting kind of area to explore further, and I'm really curious to see, you know, what people can build with this API. I've seen something called, say, Copy AI, and that uses, I think, I'm not sure if it's language models, but to generate like copywriting for advertising, or maybe it's things like writing help and these different kinds of ideas. But definitely curious to see, you know, how this can, you know, this massive number and how this API can produce this kind of value. Next up, Hugging Face's newsletter for May documents some of the really exciting things that they're adding to the Hugging Face different library. So Transformers 4.6 is adding vision models, Clip from OpenAI, the VIT vision transformer model, and the data efficient image transformer model have all been added to the Transformers library for now taking on computer vision, which is really exciting. The datasets library, a really great way to load datasets. They're showing how they've optimized it further to make it much faster. This is the time comparing 1.6 to 1.5 for loading, you know, this many examples of data. And then they're showing the premium support program, the expert acceleration program, where the Hugging Face team will offer help with which model to fine tune, how to do it, how do I reduce latency by 10x, how do I optimize my production setup, leverage transformers in SageMaker, and how do I mitigate bias in datasets and models. The inference API subscription thing, the way to integrate and serve any of the 13,000 plus Hugging Face models, or store your own private models, and then you know, using the API calls. Then the Auto NLP, a really exciting command line interface for hyperparameter optimization with these pipelines, now taking on speech recognition as well. The integration of JAX and Transformers backbone. And then looking at the Accelerate thing, I think Accelerate is, say, distributed training, this kind of idea in integrating distributed training with Hugging Face Transformers, and then some other projects like the Big Science idea of building these large language models and studying them, Wave to Vec fine-tuning week, and the integration of Big Bird to the Transformers library. And then different tutorials, distributed training on SageMaker, scaling BERT inference on the CPUs, and a PyTorch community voices video, I think maybe a tutorial or something like that. I haven't watched the video. But another really great edition of Hugging Face's newsletter, updating you and updating on the latest from Hugging Face. One of the most exciting trends in deep learning lately has been the integration of datasets and then the coding framework. So say we have things like Hugging Face's dataset loader, or TorchText, TorchVision, the Keras built-in datasets, or say like the Kaggle API, these different ways of integrating datasets and loading them into the you know, the model training without having to do too much pre-processing of your own, or say downloading it from GitHub or any kind of real work for loading datasets. So in addition to papers with code datasets feature, they're now adding the dataset loader. So in addition to seeing the different datasets that are available and the benchmarks and papers that are building on top of them, you can now see different loaders like the Hugging Face datasets, or these other loaders that can help you just load it right into PyTorch, TensorFlow, and JAX workflows. So really interesting new addition, dataset loaders to the Papers with Code dataset browsing. Thank you so much for watching the latest AI Weekly update from Henry AI Labs up to June 2nd, 2021. I hope you found some interesting content and some interesting things to fuel your research in deep learning. Thanks for watching, and please subscribe for more weekly updates and deep learning and AI videos.